We have for you tonight at this time, we have Marleen here. Marleen Stikker, she's the founder of Waag Society and Waag. Well, all things start with Waag are hers, more or less. She started the digital city, Digitale Stad, in the Netherlands. And through Waag Society, she's also responsible for something like the Fairphone, which most of you probably know. She organizes Picnic, or at least organizes Picnic, which is one of the nicest festivals in Amsterdam on technology and new things. Accompanying her is Tom here. And if for some reason, it is hardly possible with Marleen, but if for some reason she needs assistance, Tom is here, is CTO of Waag Society. Talk today will be about Decode, about taking back data for society, for yourself. So please give her a warm welcome, great applause for Marleen.
Just to explain, Tom, I will talk about the Decode project, and Tom is involved in the whole architecture for that. So. When we speak about Decode, Tom can explain a lot, but I will start more with a general introduction. Because I think one of the situations that we're in is that we are in a transition, and it has to do with the distributed nature of the internet. And there's a lot of good things coming from it. This whole distributed nature of the protocol enables people to participate, to like in 24 years ago, to build new civic parts of the internet without asking for permission. This horizontal innovation helps people to engage without the need of having a lot of capital. So there's a lot of really nice things happening because of the internet. And when I'm in the field of non-technologies, like not in a hacker's environment, I was explained it has to do with the protocol and the internet architecture. It also enables to think in other scales. So instead of thinking about global networks, we can think about translocal networks, about collaboration between local entities. Because we can distribute knowledge, distribute information, distribute software and code. So the city became more an actor in this, in the whole playing field. And it also gave rise to the commons. The whole movement around open source, open hardware, open knowledge is a very, very truthful, very interesting movement, and it's gaining momentum. More and more people are also bringing together the story about the planetary boundaries together with the natural resources, the natural commons, with the commons that we produce, that we create. And especially in the technology field, there's a lot of open commons being created. But then we have the downside. And I think a lot of people will have been talking about this. I think the person who spoke to me before was talking about the effects of this monetizing of data. So in this beautiful distributed structure, there are some really big companies that centralize the information, centralize the smartness of their services. And a lot of people talk, in a general field, people talk about sharing economy, but I think this is a very problematic term. So I prefer to talk about platform corporates, and some people will talk about surveillance capitalism. And all these big five organizations and this kind of typical huge corporations threatening sovereignty. That would not be enough if it's not also that all the capital around startups also forcing startups that want to build services on the internet in the same direction, also monetizing on data. So what will be the future of the internet? Well, it's more about the business model than the technology. I think we all understand that technology is not neutral. You can do both sides. You can create beautiful, open, distributed technologies, but you also can create monetizing on data and centralized models. So what is the business model behind all these technology? And I think this has to do with the model that we are working with, the economic model of the 20th century. This is not something that was really a fact. This is a model that's been pushed upon our societies. So it's a framework that defines how value is being created and what the exchange is between capital and labor. And this is Sam Wilson, who actually said, it must work like this. Now all we have to do is prove it. Well, we are now in the 21st century, and we realize that a part of this system, the so-called model, is not working. And we know because of Piketty, we know because of the 0.01%, we know about it because of Occupy. So there's a lot of movement in reclaiming economics and saying this model doesn't work anymore. We can't use this model to create the value structures that we need in the 21st century. So we are here to talk about technology and thinking about what's inside of the black box and trying to open algorithms, but I think we also have to talk about hacking economy and hacking the models that are actually steering the investments, steering the companies that are making technologies. So if we talk about the box, not out of the box, but about the box, what is the box, what's inside of the box? You have this very nice scheme in how the 20th century's economics works. It's sort of like an engineering drawing. All the other stuff is outside of it. So commons, social, circular, open source, sharing, cooperatives, they're all outside of this box because people will say, this is not economics. It doesn't make money. So nice that you're doing this. Nice the open source projects, but it's not part of our model. So we want to invest in IP, we want to invest in patents, we want to invest in startups that monetize on data. And we don't know how to deal with companies and organizations that create value in a commons model. So are they nice to have or need to have? That's, I think, the question. And there's a fundamental difference in the value proposition. So the platform corporate, if you, on the one hand, have a very specific idea how you can deal with their platforms, and they own everything, and you can sort of use the system, but you will have no reciprocity in it. There's nothing that you can it won't open itself, it won't give anything data back. It's just a platform, and all the intelligence is situated mostly in Silicon Valley, but of course it also counts for the Russian and Chinese and other companies that do this in other environments. And the platform corporates are based on reciprocity. They are based on transparency and collaborative ownership, which is a specific different values proposition. So yes, I think to gain back our control over our data, we have to also to think about other economic models. And we also have to start to hack economics. And I think, I'm not sure if there's ever been a big conference like 5,000 people gathering with tents about hacking economics, but it would be really great if we would have something like this. I said there are some students that are working on reclaim economics, and there are some economists that are actually rethinking economics, and Kate Raworth is one of them. I just want to plug her book, Donut Economy. I think she makes a very good attempt. She's being called the 21st century's Keynes, which is, I'm not sure if you are happy if they call you Keynes, but says something about the potential influence that you could have. And I think Kate Raworth really, really makes the step that we need to rethink and reclaim economics. So she both brings together the planetary boundaries. So we know that we can't grow on the same speed as we did. We have to redesign and rethink growth. But it's also an economics that is based on social justice. So, and we know that every nice piece of technology that we have, and it's everywhere in our camping site here, they all have a backlash, but either on the resources, the working conditions in which they've been created. Most of them are not repairable. Maybe some people here in the room know how to repair them. Most people that buy the iPhones and other stuff, they don't know how to repair their stuff, so you just throw it away. And there are a lot of conflict minerals in it. Even for the Teslas and the beautiful electric cars that run on batteries are a real problem. They're not nice solutions. Batteries are a huge problem, and they again have a lot of influence in the Congo on the places where they have the minerals to make the batteries. So the next step that Kate Raworth makes, and I think this is a very fundamental step to recognize the importance of open knowledge, open technologies, is that she makes the commons part of the economic model. So we now work in a system that the state only recognizes the market, and then they represent the citizen to deal with the market. And I think if we know that there is a lot of power and structure within society, and if you define this as a commons, as a potential creation of value, then you have to think about economics as a holistic part. And so you have to make, so the state has to define a strategy for the commons, for commons production, and not just for the market. So I think this model, what she describes, is very, I think one of the things that we have to do is to use and create new applications for cities and for states to deal with this new model of economics. So now back to technology. Because what do we want from technology? Well, we want technology that's based on civic sovereignty. We don't want to lose our sovereignty because we are using technologies. And at the moment, I think a lot of people believe it's not possible anymore. If you say, use the internet, they say, well, then you have to give up your privacy, just as if it's the same thing. But we know it has to do with the business model. It has not to do with the technology itself. It's the way the technology is being implemented. So civic sovereignty within technology is one of the most important things that we have to, well, almost conquer back, to get back. Another really important part is accountability. What are in the black box? What are the technology actually doing? What are the algorithms that are inside? They should be revealed. There should be an authority that makes companies and organizations and governments accountable for what they actually do and the rules that they imply in the technology. And then back to value proposition, I think we have to look into technologies that are based on reciprocity. It's not taking more than you get from it, which is based on something as a commons creation. So if we want this from technology, what are actually the nation states are doing, or what is Europe doing? Well, Europe, we have been mentioned already before, and if you talk about the policy space that Phil Zimmerman said as the opening speech, a lot has to do with how we define the policy space for technology. I think at the moment, Europe leads the way. I think they're most radical in what they ask from lawmakers and how we have to deal with technology, both the accountability of algorithms, both in how to deal and respect privacy. So let's say this is not maybe where we want to be, it's only the first step, but it's definitely something that has some potential. Then we look at the nation state. Well, in the Netherlands, I think most of the nation states are not the level that you believe that could be that the change will come from. Maybe under pressure of Europe in our continent, but definitely not because of the political movement inside of the nation states. The Dutch parliament just signed a surveillance law from 2018 on, the Sleepwet, and well, most of you will know that this is not what this is the opposite of what we're talking about. So maybe to see if you think about governments and that could play a role in reclaiming our control over data, then maybe cities could play an interesting role. And here I want to show some examples from Barcelona and from Amsterdam. And I think Barcelona is a very interesting space because there's a political movement that comes from the civil society. And they made very explicit that technology policy is politics. So they defined a policy that is really inclusive. So this is a quote from Francesca Bria, who is the CTO of City of Barcelona. And she says, cities are responsible for ensuring that data sovereignty is respected. They should act as an intermediary and as a custodian of these new rights. One way to go is by changing the regulations. Another way is through decentralized and encrypted infrastructure and make citizens aware of how the data is used. I think these are interesting three layers, or three steps that are in the capacity of cities. Is regulations, sometimes law, mostly that we have to expect from nation states, but also implementing and really steering the decentralized and encrypted infrastructures, but also a role in making citizens smart not the city smart, but the citizens smart, and how they understand and use technology. So Barcelona has been very explicit about the movement for city data commons, a strategy that brings together the transparency, privacy, security, and bases itself on ethical decisions. And I think to make this explicit, and that's, I think that when I talk about Amsterdam, they're very close to this, but really Barcelona is the most explicit city at the moment. They're also called the part of the rebel cities. And of course, everybody would like them to stay in power, but again, this is a very, very specific situation in Spain at the moment, in Madrid and Barcelona. And we now see if a civil movement becomes politicians, how they can change the whole approach to technology. I think this is a very, very interesting step they make. So the city of Barcelona has a strategy which is really integrated. So the digital empowerment and innovation is part of a transformation strategy. It's not separated, it's integrated. Whereas in most cities, in most countries, you have economic department, which is about innovation, and then we have somewhere an educational department that wants to have new skills for people. They will do a little bit about learning people to code. This is not an integrated strategy. It's really about integration. If you think about civil society, that we don't want to have people being skilled to code because they have more access to jobs, but we want to have code and programming skills and making skills in people because they want to become a real citizen, to understand the technology that surrounds them. City of Barcelona also made it very specific, so they have a specific procurement process. They have a strategy in the code of practices and how they deal with companies, how they deal with their internal ICT structures. They have a buying handbook, so they made it very, very actionable, not just as a theory, but as something that you really can do on the basis, on a daily basis, making it part of the instruments of a citizens, of civil servants. Well, in the city of Amsterdam, there are also some examples, but I think what I like the most is that the term smart city is not being used as positive anymore, because I think the whole term smart city is being complicated, and the city understands it as well. So there's a slight change in saying it's not about the smart city, it's about the maker city. So the make is the new smart. And I definitely like the term make better, because it says something about the agency of the citizen instead of just a structure that outsmarts you and you are like just the user. So the whole terminology, if the terminology changes, you also have to come up with other policies. And one of the steps that is being made is to draft the regulations for a responsible city. So the term, instead of smart, is now responsible cities. And of course, we don't know which one of these terms will stay, but I think both of them, I definitely prefer above the smart city. That both cities, and I think this is not just that they can apply what's already there, because we also have to figure out how we get control over our data. That's not an easy thing, and I think it has been demonstrated over the last day or two that there's so many things already happened that it's really quite complex. So in the project Decode, both cities are participating with a large group of developers. And Decode is about decentralized citizens-owned data ecosystem. So it is about providing tools to put individuals in control and also to help them to decide and to control the data in the sense if they want to keep it private or they want to donate it to the data commons. And the output for Decode is a 4-year program. Will be that it's it will be an infrastructure that can be shared and will be open sourced for others, validated in real life situations. There are really interesting partners in Decode. ThoughtWorks is involved, Arduino is involved, Dyn.org. Next to the cities, there is also Nesta and De Waag and some others. And I think this is an excellent consortium because it builds on already the experience of some very interesting companies and organizations that already made some change. So Decode will facilitate several things. It will facilitate participants to manage and access to to manage the access to their data by granting and revoke access to parts of it. So it's very much in line with the idea of reveal my attributes, that only the company needs to know that if you want to buy liquor, then it only needs to know that you're 18 plus and not all the rest of what your data body is about. So it's about how we can control what our interactions with service providers, what they know about you. Secondly, it will it facilitates that everyone to record entitlements on a distributed ledger whose integrity is resilient and verifiable. I think this is also very important that it's an open structure that people can participate in, also if you are a provider or a service partner. It makes it possible that smart contracts can only access private data based on entitlements and matched attributes. And the last step is that it facilitates operators to write these contracts, sign them, and get the authorization to run them in the Decode ecosystem. So still the Decode project is only, well, this tells, oh, here, you can see it's only in the inception phase. It's really in the early part of the project. And the language is still quite a thing because it's a platform, it's the ecosystem, it's the operating system. So this kind of language is still under development. But what's, I think, very important for Decode, it's not just a platform as technology, it will be based on real-life situations. And we're just starting to work with the pilots in the coming half year. So these are some of the pilots that we're going to run. First of all, it's Decidem. It's a platform for citizens to participate in the citizens' discussions. It's already running for a long time. It's been used in Barcelona to engage with the citizens. And within Decode, it will look into participatory budgeting using verified anonymity. And I think this is the core idea of Decode, that you have to you want to be authentic, but you don't want to reveal in all cases who you are. So the whole model is that that you can participate in budgeting, but you don't have to reveal who you are. But you are a legitimate citizen of Barcelona. The same principle we will look into in the Airbnb register for the city of Amsterdam. And maybe you are aware that in Amsterdam, like in Barcelona and other cities, it's quite a problem, Airbnb. And the city said that there's a maximum of 60 days. And they want to register that people are not exceeding that amount. And really funny that Airbnb immediately said, but that's really an infringement of privacy. It's really funny that they used that argument. But again, of course, it's vulnerable if you just register people by their name and their house and their address. And I think Airbnb said then people know that you're not at home, but the thieves will get into your home system. But this will be, with Decode, you can verify the anonymous short-stay rental register. And actually, the only two attributes that are relevant are, do you really live in the house that you let? And did you didn't exceed the 60 days? This is the only thing what's really needed. So in this case, Decode will work with the City of Amsterdam for a next phase of the register, not the one that will be implemented on the 1st of October, but the one that will follow. A third pilot is working together with Gebieds Online. It's a social network for neighborhoods. And in this case, it will be it's a platform where a lot of neighborhoods are building their own systems upon the platform. And none of them, of course, have privacy enabled. So I think the problem at the moment for a lot of these nice social innovation projects is that they don't have they have limited knowledge and limited budget to really build secure systems, which makes them very vulnerable. And Nextdoor as the platform, which is trying to put themselves as the platform like the Airbnb, is really endangering the social innovation projects that are already there. So Decode will help Gebieds Online to define privacy-enhanced applications for their platform. One of the fourth pilots will be with Fairbnb. Fairbnb is an initiative from citizens and some entrepreneurs that believe in a cooperation. So Fairbnb is a cooperation. It believes in if people rent out their house, that the money or the benefits are in the neighborhood, so that it's not in Silicon Valley the benefits, but it's inside of the cities and the neighborhoods itself. One of the very, very difficult parts of Airbnb and others and Ubers is that your reputation is also managed somewhere central, and you don't have access to the reputation management. So within the pilot of Airbnb, we will look into the portable reputation, so if you can get control back over your reputation. So this is some of the ideas about how Decode could work in different contexts. Decode will be, as I said, something which is open and usable for others as well. But we will first have to figure out how to make it work in the infrastructure. And what I think is very interesting, that's why if we want to reclaim our identity and reclaim our data, of course, it's about awareness. So if people know what's happening, then maybe they are more aware. Maybe they start to use Signal instead of WhatsApp. Maybe they're going to leave Facebook and start to use Mastodon, which is still not as user-friendly as you would like it to be. So there are, of course, for certain aspects of the internet, there are some alternatives that are end-to-end encrypted, or you can sort of trust the networks and applications. But most of them, they have to rely on infrastructure that's there and is trusted. By default, by design, and I don't believe that the nation states are the ones that will help us to implement this. I think cities can be really help. So this is, for example, a way how Barcelona believes how Decode and other parts of it could become an ecosystem that can be trusted. And in this context, I think it makes sense to believe that cities could drive this movement. As long as the citizens are smart enough to participate in the process. So I want to end with the technopolitics village that we have around the corner. And I think what's really nice about this collaboration between the Internet Society and Bits of Freedom, De Waag, Data Active, Bureau Janssen & Janssen, Grip One, Contrast Networks, and all the others, is that we all believe that technology is politics. So you have to have. So it means that if you start to think about this strategy, then you have to engage with people that are non-technologists and try to make them understand that it's not as crypto as they think it is. That they can have a role in defining the values that we want in our future technologies. So thank you very much.
And thank you, Marleen. You surprised me actually a bit by stopping already. I was enjoying it and thought, go on, but excellent. So there's loads of time for Q&A here for you. So that's excellent. So who has the honor of the first question?
Thank you for this
interesting talk. Please speak close to the microphone. You could, if you can almost eat it, it's right.
All right. I hear myself better now as well. Thanks for this talk. I was wondering, what is it that sets cities apart from nation states in organizing all this? And how do city states such as Singapore, which is also working very hard, but also centralistic and top down on what would they still call a smart city, how do they fit in this whole picture?
Well, I absolutely agree that, like Singapore, it's almost a nation state. So Singapore is the nation in a certain way. And there are the cities that are, I think it's about scale. So every city that's too large would not work. It is about cities that have a certain, that people still have relationships, that you can still organize a real discussion. I think Barcelona, before this, these new people that are there, it was a very hierarchical, structured city. So I think that the whole idea about rebel cities is that they engage in a different way with the citizens. They believe in a different politics. So it's definitely to do with the way that they think that politics should work and how democracy should work. So I'm afraid that not all cities will be in place to do this.
And are you talking about city-specific or municipalities broader? So could these also be more rural areas where maybe the surface of a municipality is much larger, but the population density much lower?
I think the villages could be a very interesting structure, but they don't have a lot of people free for innovation. They don't have a lot of budgets to participate in these experiments and building new infrastructures. So if they would collaborate and be part of it, yes, because of the scale, they could be very well positioned. But they have a problem in that they don't are big enough to have a CTO who can run programs and participate and have a procurement process that's in place.
Okay, thank you.
And thank you.
Well, it aligns very much with the ideas of Lady Guerot. It's a German lady who analyzed the European Union, and she recognized that it should be the future of Europe should be a number of bigger city areas. And that you see already Rotterdam being rather self-conscious. You see Amsterdam being self-conscious. You see that they are starting to cooperate with other cities. So that is the new core of activity. But I have one thing to add. I've also recognized in Europe that there's a kind of new trade route, which are called Corridoria, which runs from middle of England to Rotterdam and then to the Ruhr area, to Bavaria, and then all the way to Istanbul. And you can see from the other side that the Chinese are building this infrastructure to connect very large cities and to sell stuff. It's Obor, they call it. So we can meet them halfway in Europe. So also my invitation is think about the next step, that we build chains of cities. Because otherwise, you have an optimum size, but what is the next step? Do you want the whole of Netherlands to be called Amsterdam? Well, maybe that's reasonable, but...
Mm-hmm. I think if we believe in this, if we think about the structure of translocality, then we talk about cities and regions. So instead of just talking about cities, you can also talk about regions. The people believe that the future of Europe should be a federation of cities and regions. And the meetings in Brussels that are about the regional meetings are actually discussing this kind of topics at the moment. So there is something happening there, but I guess the nation states will not surrender just by us liking the idea. So there is a lot of tension between nation states and regions and cities in the European context.
Could you please phrase it as a question?
Well, no. I'm the mayor of Corridoria, and I make the list of cities. And if you really want, you can talk to me, and maybe you can be on the list.
Okay.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Love to be on the list.
I have yet another question. Because I've been wondering, back in the days, I believe cities were more in charge of what was going on. And for example, they had all the energy companies. And in the end, they decided to sell it. I think Eneco in the Netherlands is an example of that. And how would you prevent this happening again? Because I think it's really noble to rebuild all sorts of infrastructure for this century. But what if the leadership changes and they see it again as just... some capital that they can sell at some point to make profits for whatever their agenda is.
We come from a situation that everything which was cooperative has been sold to companies. So every commons that we had, both land, water, energy, are being privatized and are part of the financial system. If you look at the energy transition, you can go back and thinking about establishing large cooperative companies, Are you looking into the cooperatives that are already starting to arise coming from citizens? And again, I think because of the distributed nature of technology and that we don't need a lot of centralized models in the technology anymore, we don't need huge investments in factories because we have distributed factories, distributing manufacturing, distributed energy systems. So I think we can think about other governance structures.
But
it definitely is not. This is changing the narrative. So the current narrative is still believing in the market. So if I say that we have to hack economy, it's one of the most difficult things to do because this is not in line with how the startup thinking is. I think whole Europe wants to be Silicon Valley. Paris just set up an incubator with thousands of people, but Amazon is actually. It's all based on the same idea that startups will make a huge lot of money because they will data monetize and they will be extractive economists. So I think the change of the narrative is not an easy step. And if you look at, for example, at universities, students that want to have another curriculum, they don't have a lot of say in the universities. So if this is still a huge battle. This is not. But I just want to say that some people within cities are actually opening up to the new discourse.
Okay, thanks.
Would you please go back into your slides a little bit?
Could you stand close to the mic, please? Yeah, you're allowed to.
Could the mic
raise
close to my face?
How far?
Well, a little further. Oh, actually,
I can start all over again.
I have no idea. Actually, to the part with the donut economy first. I think that was in the beginning. Yeah, this one.
Yeah.
All right, so you'll notice that to the top right, it says donut economics, which is makes me think it's about economics. And I look at the donut here, and it looks more like a government model where you attempt to constrict economic space to outside of what she calls the social foundation, which includes things that are not currently in any social foundation anywhere. Networks, for example, are totally private. And then she mentions ecological ceiling, which is something that there is also no proper agreement upon. So this is not about economics at all. I feel like, I don't see an economical argument here. I only see a model for how you would design your governance model.
Do you see a model here, a real, do you think this has any proof?
We're closer because we have wages, interest, and savings, and these are clear flows of capital.
And you don't believe that there are planetary boundaries?
I would say that there probably are, and we have just no idea where they are.
They're based on Ostrom, which is a scientist that I think is being part of also the...
No, I agree generally with the United Nations board that attempts to model the economic or the ecological foresight, and I do believe that after the Middle East migrant flow will ebb down, we will have a new migrant flow from Indonesia.
I'm talking about planetary boundaries, not about migrant flow.
Well, you just wait. Because
I know they're related,
the Earth will not become habitable, and that will create new migrant flows. It'll be great.
Either you say that the planetary boundaries are a set of rules and a set of ideas about how our resources are limited, and these are, if economics is about household. So if you don't have sugar anymore, you can't make sweet pie, so you have to think about something else. So if you think about the planet as a household, then the planetary boundaries are well defined by scientists and by economists as well. So the planetary boundaries are not just like a made-up idea. I think what's much more made-up is our financial system, which is a totally fake story. It's based on liabilities between people that have debt. But is that real? Or is this just relationships of people that keep each other in this cage? So But I don't understand why the one part is economics and the other is not.
I think when you talk about economics, you're talking about the accounting of value and who's adding value and who's subtracting value and who deserves what.
And so what has
when
value
I look here,
for you?
I'm not looking at anything related to financial flows. I'm looking at boundaries of where
maybe,
we can do.
I have the book with me. Maybe check the book and see
and
if you
way,
can
continue
convince you.
A couple of slides because this was like part one of the thing I wanted to say. Could we go to the slides about Airbnb and Fairbnb, please?
This one?
Okay. Yeah, well, maybe actually one back is also fine. Okay. okay, so Fairbnb, I actually responded to one of the initial manifesto things as there is just no reasonableness to this whatsoever. And it also has the implication that Airbnb is unfair. Which is just, I mean...
Okay.
The technologically...
I think I heard you discussing the whole story about privacy earlier, and I think you have a position that you don't believe in things anymore. And I know that nothing can be really optimized. I think there's nothing which is totally good. There's no way that Fairbnb will be totally fair. Like Fairphone is not fair. It's only an attempt to get to be more fair.
I feel pretty
others.
Sad that you were involved because I totally recommended someone not to buy it because it wouldn't really make a difference. But I'm wondering more about, so you talk first about how you'd use technology to do, like to be more political, to have technology be more political. But then you ran off, went on this economic sidetrack basically, and you know, Fairbnb is just criticizing Airbnb for not being efficient, even though it really is.
Could you phrase it as a final question, please?
No, I'm not that good at questions. I'm just not.
Well, it's pretty simple.
Here is,
it's got a question mark at the end.
Why would technology enhancing politics, and enhancing our ability to do politics, enhancing our ability to communicate and to agree and to make law and to enforce those laws, why would it be so intricately connected with your political opinions?
Okay, political opinions are something else, but I think if anything, technology is rule-based. If anything, politics is rule-based. If anything, economy is rule-based. So behind, underneath, in every of these value systems, there are structures that are saying inclusive or exclusive. So each of these are based on rules. And every rule-based system is biased by default. It's not neutral. So you have to define if you make technology or if you have a law, you are not neutral. So there's no neutral position here. So therefore, I see absolutely that technology, politics, economics are all based on certain value systems that you have to make explicit before you just say that it has to be like this. So in the 21st model of economics is being presented as something that it has to be like this. This is how economics works. And I believe that more and more people are, and also economists, also within circular economy, people are defining that economics could be something else, depending on your value system. And my argument is technology could behave differently if you have another value system. So it starts with your value system. It starts with who you want, what do you want to be, do you want to monetize your, do you believe in cooperation, do you believe in competition? Do you think that the law of nature is that we have to compete with each other? Or do we believe that we survive because we are cooperators, that we only can live because we are cooperative together? So this kind of, in the end, you come back to what is your position in how you believe what is the nature of human beings. And I think most of our systems are now based on competition and based on a very specific idea about how it should work. And I think we could start from another position, but then we have to recognize the strength of cooperation, then we have to recognize the strength of sharing in a reciprocity way, then we have to believe in the way that people can cooperate and create value together. But that means that you also have to change your idea about how economics works.
So now we're getting philosophical. Now for philosophy, you probably need, or at least I need, more more drinks. And normally, the person here says, the herald says, drink more water. In this case, drink more vodka might be better. But may I invite you to come over to the Waag village, the Tsja village, and to have to follow up on this discussion afterwards? Cheers. That'd be great. Now, there's one more thing that I would like to ask Tom, because everyone has been harassing Marleen all the time, and that is fine. That's why she's on stage. But I have this question. You're CTO of Waag Society, right? May I invite you to the microphone? And Marleen has been telling that Barcelona has a CTO as a city. Now, yep. I have not heard of any Dutch city which has a CTO. Probably there are some, but no, they don't pwn themselves as CTOs, or at least not in my memory. What do you say about the position of a CTO for a local government? How important is that to you?
I think it's very important. Amsterdam does have a CTO since how long? 4 years? 5 years? He's not very public, but his strategies and things and the priorities that he defines in the city, innovation policies, they are influential. I mean, I think in this day and age, I think every big organization, whether they're public or private, should have a view and a vision about the technology that they're using and making and building.
And for example, Zeewolde, the municipality here, does Zeewolde need a CTO, in your opinion?
I think every single body needs somebody with a vision and a strategy around technology. So yes, I think Zeewolde needs a CTO,
yes,
if you want to call it a CTO. No.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for dinner and drinks. Be it vodka or water. I've got one announcement to make. Would you please pass me that paper? But first, before I make that announcement, another big round of applause for Marleen, please. Thank you. Okay.